This postcard is from a time when it cost just one penny to send a brief message such as thinking of you or hope to see you soon or wish you were here. Besides serving as an inexpensive means of communications, these postcards also serve to advertise the attractions and delights of a city to prospective visitors and tourists. The picture postcards also served as an historical record of the growth of a city. Here then are greetings from San Jose, then and now. Postcards promoting cities were common into the early years of the 20th century. Can you imagine hundreds of cities across the country, each with its own arrow postcard? This is a view of San Jose's famous light tower at the intersection of Santa Clara and Market Streets, taken a few years before it collapsed. In those days, photographers would take black and white pictures and then tell postcard companies what colors to use to hand tint the image. J.J. Owen, publisher of the Mercury newspaper, was fascinated with the relatively new discovery of the electric light. He was the prime mover in the construction of the light tower in 1881. The idea was to turn it on at night and light San Jose for safety and convenience. While the light did spread a considerable distance, it was too diffused for any practical use. Maintenance, neglect, and a high wind led to its collapse in 1915. This picture was taken near the turn of the century. Note the women's dresses. The ornate building on the left is on the site of the present Bank of America building in downtown San Jose at Park Center Plaza. This view looks north toward the tower at Market and Santa Clara. The photographer was standing in Plaza Park, where the fountain across from the Fairmont Hotel is located today. Plaza Park was the center of the city. Notice the light tower and St. Joseph's Cathedral. The building in the foreground is today's art museum. This building was originally the post office. Then it became the city library, and today it is the San Jose Art Museum. Note that the peaked roof seen in the last picture is no longer on the tower. It was destroyed in the 1906 earthquake. The building was made with blocks of brown sandstone cut from the Goodrich Quarry, later called the Greystone Quarry, located 8 miles south of San Jose. Blocks of stone cut from this same quarry were later used to construct Stanford University's original buildings. San Jose's finest hotel at the turn of the century was the Vendome. It was located just north of downtown. It sustained heavy damage in the 1906 quake, but it remained in business after the repairs were made. Damage from the 1906 quake was severe in both San Francisco and San Jose. About 26 miles from downtown San Jose is a landmark we see from almost anywhere in the valley, Lick Observatory. It was a monumental undertaking to build in 1888. All the building materials and the telescopes had to be hauled to an altitude of 4,209 feet over steep and twisting dirt roads. Its telescopes are still being used in the ongoing exploration of the universe. Alum Rock Park was a very popular resort during its first 75 years. The building in the picture was called a natatorium, or indoor swimming pool. It housed a large public swimming pool with diving platforms and a long water slide. It also had over 50 bathtubs for soaking in mineral waters. Sadly, this building, the place of many a happy afternoon, no longer exists. Getting to Alum Rock Park was part of the fun. Streetcars could be taken from downtown right into the park. The route even had a tunnel near the present entrance to the park. The old trolley roadbed is now part of a park trail for horses. In more recent times, such recreational facilities have been removed in order to devote the park's resources to nature and nature studies. Here we see passengers disembarking from the trolley at the park. The development of transportation has always been a major concern for the city. These folks at New Almaden were preparing for their 12-mile ride into San Jose. The advent of the electric trolley provided a convenient mode of transportation for many, many years. Initially, the trolley shared the right-of-way with horse-drawn vehicles. And later, on the same corner, we see the automobile, which would become the favored means of getting people from one place to another in and about San Jose. The cars in this scene indicate that this postcard was made in the 1920s or early 30s. Several of these buildings are still standing today. Note the two-way traffic and double streetcar lines. Note the overhead grid of trolley lines in the sky above the street. The trolley network was extensive. It ran through Campbell and down what would later become Stevens Creek Boulevard. And out into Saratoga. Here we see a trolley trestle that was built along a route that is now the Saratoga-Sunnyvale Road. This is the same trestle with a trolley approaching. Then, as now, there were occasional trolley mishaps. Looking at this scene makes one wonder why there were not more trolley accidents. Note the pedestrian standing on the tracks. The last trolley ride took place on April 10, 1938. At midnight of that date, electric trolley car service ended in San Jose. Regretfully, on that last evening, teenagers vandalized and otherwise tore apart the cars and helped themselves to souvenirs. Some cars were scrapped and some went into storage. Workers from the WPA, or the Works Projects Administration, dug up the track, which the city sold as scrap for $27,000. The trolley was replaced by a fleet of buses similar to this one. But flowers, not wheels, were once San Jose's trademark. Santa Clara Valley, now so famous for its silicon industries, was once world-renowned for its beauty and its superb fruits and vegetables, particularly apricots and prunes. At one time, one-third of all the world's prune crop was grown here. Many views of the orchards in bloom were featured on postcards. Blossoms from prune trees stretched almost as far as the eye could see. This picture was probably taken near Blossom Hill Road, looking northeast. The Valley of Heart's Delight was a trademark title for our area. Every year in late June or early July, travelers could see the sight of apricots drying in the sun on nearly every open piece of land near apricot trees. The apricots were first cut in half, the pits removed, and then they were doused with burning sulfur before being placed on wooden trays for drying in the sun. Prunes were picked off the ground in late summer. The work was hard on the knees and very tiring. Many school-aged children had to work picking prunes to help support their families, and schools did not start until the harvest was over. Before the harvest, farmers would remove the dry grass between the trees and smooth the ground to make gathering the fruit that much easier. Prunes were also dried in the sun. Notice that the trays sit on small railroad cars. The cars were pushed by hand to their next destination. Most ranches installed narrow gauge tracks just for this purpose. Not all of the fruit was dried. Apricots, peaches, pears, vegetables, and even some prunes were canned for shipment around the world. This early cannery was located near what is now the flea market in the Berryessa section of San Jose. As time went on, the canneries became more and more mechanized. Here we see wagons entering and leaving the San Jose Fruit Packing Company. This building was the headquarters for the Santa Clara Growers Packing and Warehousing Association. San Jose was noted for more than its produce, but ostriches? At that time, it was quite fashionable to wear clothing and hats that were trimmed with ostrich feathers. One such ostrich farm, whose purpose was to harvest ostrich feathers, was located on Alum Rock Avenue. San Jose was proud of her many beautiful and distinctive public buildings, such as the City Hall, designed in 1887 by famed architect Theodore Lenzen and constructed at a cost of $139,500. The first city council meeting was held there in 1889. Although made of brick, it did survive the 1906 earthquake when many other brick buildings did not. City Hall was located where the fountains now play in Plaza Park. The police station was in the basement and a pass-through driveway ran under and out the other side. Here is that same building, about 60 years later, showing how well it had withstood the ravages of time. However, it appeared that way from the outside only. Inside, one could look up and see the sky through large cracks in the roof. The building was demolished in the 1950s. This is today's City Hall, built in 1958 when city government was moved from downtown to North First Street. Currently, we hear occasional talk of moving City Hall back to a downtown location. Not far from City Hall was O'Brien's Candy Store, a downtown landmark that survived well into the 1950s. However, O'Brien's, along with most downtown businesses, fell victim to the trend to leave downtown for shopping malls. A small replica of this candy shop is open for business at the San Jose Historical Museum in Kelly Park. Another of the city's distinctive public buildings was San Jose High School, located at 7th and San Fernando Streets, now a corner of the San Jose State University campus. It was the only public high school in the city and was constructed in 1898 for the princely sum of $100,000. It was at the time one of San Jose's finest showplaces for all to admire. Thousands of postcard photos were mailed all over the nation. Unfortunately, the San Francisco earthquake of 1906 also did great damage in San Jose. The high school building was declared a total loss, but hardly had the dust settled when plans for a new school came off the drawing boards, and within 2 years, it was rebuilt on the site of the old building, bigger than ever. Once again, thousands of postcards showing it in ruins after the earthquake were mailed across the country. By 1908, the building had two wings, one of which is out of the picture to the right. Between them was an entranceway and auditorium, both of which were destroyed by fire in the mid-1930s. However, the school remained open, serving more than 2,800 students, until it was replaced by the current San Jose High at 24th and Julian Streets. In 1952, that happened at a cost of $2,775,000. Water, or the lack of it, has always been an important concern in San Jose. This is the Guadalupe, which we call a river, but it really is no more than the size of a large creek. It frequently overflowed its banks in the rainy season, but had little water for the rest of the year. Dams built in the 1930s prevented flood scenes like this in later years. People once enjoyed a Sunday afternoon on the Guadalupe, and with the creation of the new Guadalupe River Park, that may once again be possible. Alviso, a San Jose neighborhood at the foot of the San Francisco Bay, was once a small active port. Goods from the valley were often shipped out of Alviso. The coming of the railroad played a large role in causing its demise as a port. Because we have pumped up water from below the valley floor for many years, the land in this picture is now much lower than it was and must now be protected by dikes. Here we see a pleasure outing embarking from busy Alviso. People have also long traveled to Santa Cruz for pleasure and recreation. Until the late 1930s, the road to Santa Cruz was a winding, torturous two-lane affair that turned a trip to the coast into an adventure. You are looking at Highway 17. Many improvements have been made since it opened, but the road hasn't become much safer or any less congested. Perhaps we should have kept the Suntan Special, the train that ran from San Francisco and Oakland to Santa Cruz. Here's an ad for that excursion that once cost San Joseans $1.50 for a round trip to Santa Cruz. With the rapid expansion of the automobile in this century, a place to stay at night became very important. This auto court, a term frequently used in the early years, was located on 13th Street, which was then the main road to Oakland before the completion of Highway 880. San Jose made a number of significant strides in transportation in the 1930s. This is the railroad depot that was abandoned when the current station was built west of downtown. It was located at North 1st and Bassett Streets. The line from San Jose to Los Angeles ran from here to 4th Street and then south past San Jose State University. From 1939 on, San Jose was the city of the automobile. One of the first manufacturing plants to locate in this valley was the Ford Motor Company Automobile Assembly Plant, which arrived in the 1950s. The plant was located in what is now Milpitas. Moffett Field's hangar may look very big when viewed from the highway, but the U.S. dirigible Macon took up most of its room. Built in the 1930s, the field was taken over by the Army Air Force when the Macon crashed into the Pacific off of Point Sur on February 12, 1935. Later, the Navy resumed command of Moffett Field. Incidentally, the wreckage of the Macon was not located until 1990. The De Anza Hotel first opened in the 1930s and for years was the city's most modern hotel. It is located downtown on West Santa Clara Street. This picture was taken after World War II and is looking east. San Jose has always had excellent hospital services. San Jose Hospital has been at 15th and East Santa Clara Streets since 1923. This picture was probably taken several years after it opened. A few years ago, this picture would have been titled San Jose Hospital Today. However, it has since been remodeled and expanded once again. The large redwood tree is still in place. For many years, it grew through the center of the main lobby as seen in this picture. The USO Hospitality House provided servicemen and women a home away from home during World War II. It was built at the corner of Market and San Carlos Streets at the south end of Plaza Park. It took only one day, August 16, 1941, to finish construction of the hospitality house. Material and labor were donated by trade union craftsmen. The top of the original city hall can be seen through the trees. You can see the bell in the foreground still in place today, although the hospitality house is no longer standing. One reason downtown San Jose has changed so much over the years was the trend for stores to move to the outlying areas. Here is an early photo of Valley Fair. The Emporium is at the top left. Macy's and Valley Fair are in the middle, near the top, and the freeway is under construction at the right. Here we see Valley Fair with the new freeway in place. Note the distance between the Emporium at the top and the stores in the middle. Much of the Valley Fair you are viewing was later torn down, and the two large stores were connected. Before San Jose could be rebuilt as it is today, it was virtually torn down. Notice the open areas behind the Civic Auditorium and across the street where the Convention Center is now located. This picture was probably taken in the late 1960s. Remember the old trolleys? They have now made a comeback as the new light rail system. The Civic Auditorium and the new city skyline are in the background. However, trolleys, now called light rail, have made a comeback. Here we see a refurbished car from the early part of the century. It runs downtown alongside the modern light rail cars. The restoration work on this antique car has been done by volunteers at the San Jose Historical Museum. This new postcard shows San Jose today as evening approaches. The new Fairmont Hotel dominates the backdrop to the right. We've had a vibrant past, but changes occurring right now forecast an even more exciting future. Much has already been accomplished that will make San Jose a business and cultural mecca. This photo was taken from the new Guadalupe Parkway sweeping down into the heart of the city. The skyline from this angle is enlivened by our new purple Children's Discovery Museum on Oise Way. We are evolving into a city of inviting boulevards and clean new design. Attracting people with excellent restaurants, hotels, and cultural events. Our art museum, once the post office and the library, has just added a new $15 million wing partially visible to the right in this photo. Plaza Park has an attractive new design and landscaping while retaining a symbol of our past, the USO Bell. We are a city that remembers its past, as symbolized by these coyote sculptures gracing the bridge over the Guadalupe River downtown. One beloved symbol of our heritage is the recently restored St. Joseph's Cathedral on Market Street. And once again, the trolley has returned to our streets. Our new light rail system now connects to homes in South San Jose and businesses in Santa Clara. San Jose offers its citizens high-quality entertainment both from local companies and from nationally and internationally acclaimed artists. Here is Canada's Cirque du Soleil during its recent stop in San Jose. San Jose's new convention center is on San Carlos Street next to the Martin Luther King Jr. Public Library. The light tower may be gone, but a new San Jose is emerging. The same civic pride that built the landmarks of our past now enables us to create the city of our future.